don't believe God will bring us this far. Thank you.
Say thank you, because you woke us up this morning. The alarm clock didn't wake us up. Nobody called us and woke us up. You touched us with that finger of love this morning. Told our golden moments to roll on a little while longer. And we thank you, Lord, that we were able to see the breaking of a new day. Your mercy is anew every morning. Every day you give us a new day that we've never seen before, never shall see again. And we're grateful this morning, Lord, for your blessings. And a lot of people think that because you're not driving a new car or you're not wearing the latest fashions and all that, you're not blessed. But if you look back over your life, you see where God has brought you through situations that you couldn't get out of yourself. It had to be God that brought you through, because you didn't do it on your own. Mama couldn't do it, daddy couldn't do it, sister, brother couldn't do it. It was Jesus who ordered our steps this morning. Jesus who put it in our hearts to come to this place of worship this morning. to give him some thanks for what he has done for us in our lives. Where he has brought us from to where he has brought us to. We didn't get here on our own. God ordered our steps. And I'm grateful this morning to have a God who thought enough of little old me and you to send his only son Jesus into the world to die for our sins, that we might be reconciled back to God and to know the truth that Jesus is alive and well. He died one time and he's not going to die anymore. And he's seated at the right hand of God in heavenly places, and he's soon to come again. We pray now for those families that have been affected by COVID. Pearson and Urban and Croon and all of the other people, my Father, that we may not realize this morning. And for those who might be affected in the future, we pray your saving grace. Your saving grace because of your blood and water that was shed on the cross of Calvary to cleanse us from our sins, to make us new and whole again. And God, we thank you for your love, your kindness, and your goodness and mercy. Let them know, my Father, you don't make mistakes. Nothing you've done has been a mistake. And for whatever reason you decided to take out of the world these souls, my brother and sister, you've already paid the price for them. You paid the price out on Calvary one day where they stretched you high and hung you high and put nails in your hand and crown of thorns on your head, pierced you in the side, and out came blood and water. Blood for our redemption, water for our baptism, and you paid the price for our sins. And all we have to do is accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior this morning. We pray that you will strengthen those families. We pray that you will strengthen this pastor. We pray that you will strengthen this congregation, my Father. We pray that you will lift them up and you will keep them lifted up, my Father, in your word and in your prayer and in your grace and in your mercy. Because we need you now. If there was ever a time that we need Jesus, we need him now. Because it looks like people are trying to tear us down on every side. Pull the rug out from under us at every hand. But there's one thing for sure. Devil might try, but the devil is not going to win, because Jesus told Peter, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the very gates of hell shall not prevail against it. We're not going to lose. The battle's already been fought, and the victory's already been won, and Jesus has taken his place at the right hand of the Father. So we are victorious. We're conquerors. But we got to have faith. But faith without works is dead. We pray now for this country. Some people might have problems with America, but it's more and better than a whole lot of countries around the world. And women, if there's anybody who ought to be celebrating Christ now, is women, because the book of Luke set them free. Gave them the opportunity to worship God and to do the things that are necessary to get his word out. Father, we thank you for the women that are here. And I'm reminded of the question you asked in the garden when you came walking in the cool of the evening. Adam, Adam, where are you? You knew where he was, Lord, but you wanted him to respond in a positive way. And you're asking that question again today. Adam, where are you? I left my creation in your hands. Adam, where are you? And I believe the question, the answer is going to come back, Lord. I hid because I've done wrong. But the Lord killed an animal, gave him another chance. And as he does, all of us, gives us another chance to get things right. Lord, we ask these blessings and these commands in your name and in my Jesus' name. We pray that you will be blessed, and we pray that God will ever walk with you, because he promised never to leave us nor forsake us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When you hear about home.
Father, we thank you for fixed business in Jesus' name and for these gifts.
Missionary Baptist Church. Last Sunday was more special to me than mere words can express. The manner in which your love was expressed will forever be etched in my memory. $2,000 is no small amount coming directly from your pockets to mine. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I will leave the mission offering today with $200. Mission possible. Maxine. On February 6th, 2022, will be 40 years of our pastor preaching. He had a vision to raise $40,000 for the church. And we're asking everyone to let's raise that $40,000. 40 people can give $1,000 above their tithes and offering. 53 people can give $750. 50 people can give $500. And 160 people can give $250 above their tithes and offering. And Reverend, sometimes we put our money in 401k, we put it in the stock market, but we see that a crash. But one thing about it, we invest in the vision that you have. One thing we know, God can never fail. So we trust in this vision. God has shown time and time again that he's never failed. And if you pray and ask him the purpose in your heart to make this investment, he'll show you that he won't fail and that he can't fail. Also, we're selling t-shirts, and we would like for everyone to purchase a t-shirt. Next Sunday will be the fifth Sunday. We're asking everyone, if you have purchased a shirt, to please wear your shirt. And you still have time to purchase a shirt this Sunday and get it before next Sunday. So please come see Miss Anita Lewis right after church to purchase your t-shirt. And lastly, please see Satara to make sure that you get in for your ads. We do have a form outside that's very detailed about the ad, so you can contact her about it. But please, let's purchase an ad that we're using for this $40,000, and so to give something special to our pastor for his 40 years of anniversary with showing that your love on this pledge. But thank you so much.
God bless you, and we will govern ourselves according to the announcements. God bless you. Thank you, Sister Weatherspoon. Amen. Amen. Leading us in worship and prayer. Enthusiastic and spiritual manner. Amen. I enjoy the worship experience. Amen. And morning, God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. In times like these, you need a Savior. In times like these, you need an anchor. So you be sure. Be very sure your anchor holds and grips a solid rock. In times like these, you need
a Savior. In times like these, you need a help. So you be sure, be very sure. In times like these, you need not be idle. So you be sure, be very sure. Your a solid rock.
33, I want to talk this morning about the making of a missionary. And we still emphasize it, place an emphasis on mission here in the month of August. Some of you may be saying, well, we're tired of hearing about mission. You remember when we were told to do something and you keep failing to do it. To forget sometimes important things, that's something you need to forget. But there are some things that are important to the life of the church and the well-being of the work that we should have indelibly impressed in our hearts and in our memory. The making of a missionary. Exodus chapter 3, beginning in verse 1, said, now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire. And the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. He said, here am I. And he said, draw not nigh hither, put all thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon you standeth is holy ground. And moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrow. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land, a large unto a land flowing with milk and honey, and unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites, and to the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me. And I've also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. The making of a here. Let me begin by saying that missionary is not a novel concept, and it is not only a New Testament concept. Mission is old and defined. This case, and I'll make this case, with the character of Moses, is that God sends him. Missionaries are one who are sent by God to do a certain task. Amen. A missionary is not on his own. Missionaries do not show up with their own itinerary and their own agenda. Missionary is one who goes to do the bidding of the one who sent him or her. And this morning, I want to talk about the making of a missionary, because Moses, in the truest sense of the word, was a missionary. And the making of a missionary, needless to say, but I will say, the making of a missionary, simply put, involved people. That's point one. Amen. It involves people. Mission is originated by God, but it involves people. It is the type of ministry or service of people rendering service to people. For those of you who say that you love the Lord and that you're going to serve the Lord, you serve God by serving people. Now, I don't know if God gets hungry, but people do. And the Lord said that if he was hungry, he wouldn't get it. The Lord do not get sick. People do. The Lord is not homeless. This God who is everywhere and make earth his footstool. But there are some people who have nowhere to stay. Oppression. There's no hand, there's no government, there's no entity, there's no power that is strong enough to subjugate God and to oppress him. But throughout the history of mankind and all over the world today, there are those who, with their strong arms and their political will and might, subjugate people and oppress people all over the world. Now, if you really want to anger God and to get God to move against you, you be in the business of oppression and causing chaos in the life of others. And this was the case of the Israelite people. They were under oppression. They were being abused by others,
And the Lord raised up a person. God raises up people to help other people. And so then God uses people. Now, most of us like to identify with characters in the Bible, especially those who are known for doing extraordinary things and performing great miracles and making things change for the better in big ways. But God uses people. You don't have to be particularly and especially gifted for God to use you. Some folk went down, grab a microphone in church and sing a song, and they quickly tell you, I can't sing. But let me tell you some, brothers and sisters, you may not have a melodious voice. You may not be able to belt out notes like Aretha Franklin, or you may not be a crooner, amen, but if God have blessed you, amen, your voice may be cracking and you probably can't carry a tune in a bucket, but if God has delivered you, if God has, if he saved you, you got a song. No, you have a song. If you ever sat down and thought about it, that you deserve hell, you was on your way to hell, you ought to go to hell, should have been in hell, amen. But when you look around, that God loved you enough to save you, he give you a song. If it's not but one line, I was a lost, but now I'm found. Blind but now I see. Don't have to be particularly gifted. God uses people. As a matter of fact, the making of a missionary, Moses, was just question. He had a colorful background, but he was just question. Moses was privileged to be raised as the grandson in the house and in the palace of Pharaoh, but one day he saw an Egyptian beating a fellow Hebrew, and no matter what his training was, no matter what his course of education was, the people came out of him. You know, live the best you can. Try to live a holy life and a good life, but every now and then, people show up. And Moses, with all of his prerogative, with all of his privileges of living in the palace, he rose up and slew an Egyptian for beating his brother and buried him in the sand. And Pharaoh found out, and just because Moses was just ordinary people, Moses got out of Dodge. And if there was a post office in Egypt, you would see Moses' picture on that, posted in the post office across the top, would say, Most Wanted. And now he's a fugitive from justice, and he's on the backside of the Midianite desert feeding his father-in-law flock, because Moses found out that he gets people. You know, a lot of us like to make big stuff out of folk. Amen, because of who they are. Amen, what family they were born to. We make big stuff about people because of their worldly accomplishments. Amen. They got money. And somebody said at the end of the day, no, not at the end of the day, at the beginning of the day, you just people. That's all. And Moses was one of those persons that God chose to be a missionary for him. And I said all of that to say this, is that God called folks and God trusts his work with people like you and me. Look at Moses. He's a fugitive from justice. Moses got the blood of a man on his hand. He's not living like a prince from the palace. He's out in the field herding sheep. And then, not only that, but Moses did not stay in the palace long enough to get speech therapy. He's inarticulate. He stutters when he talks. But God called him. So no matter what your state or what your station in life, no matter what side of the tracks you're on, no matter what your level of religion or spirituality is that God called a people like you and me to do his work. Amen, flaws and all. Because what God wants to do, the reason why God called folk like us, because he wants to remind us that the work is not our work, amen, the deliverance is not our deliverance, and that God's work is not based upon your personality, but it is based upon his power. So he calls it. Well, the making of a missionary, God uses persons. But the second making of a missionary is that God also calls us to preparation. Amen. Now some folk want to know, and I've been asked on several occasions, are preachers born or are they made? And to the answer is both of them. Preachers are born. But for an effective preacher and a good preacher, he has to be made. Dr. Blackburn. Some people have they're musically inclined. But to be a good musician, it takes preparation. Some people have the gift to teach. But before you start teaching, you need to stop by somebody's classroom. And the making of a missionary, a making of a good servant of God requires preparation. And sometimes God uses some strange ways of preparing us. Now that's really point three, but let me go point two and I'll come back to point three. Just work with me. Point two is that in order to be a servant of God, God has to preserve you. You want to know why you're still here? God has preserved you for his purpose. Now some of you may be 20, some of you may be 30, some of you may be 40, 50, 60, 70, and so on. And some of us, it really takes that long for God to get the ultimate use out of us, but he has to preserve us. I was talking with somebody one yesterday, and we were talking about all of the people who have passed away, and we think, you know, that you have to be sick, amen. But let me tell you something, brothers and sisters, even if you are not sick, the only reason you are still here is that God preserved you. You ain't got to catch COVID to die. You see, Moses, now you cannot look through his yearbook and see by his name that he's the one who is most likely to succeed. Because in the first place, Moses were not, he wasn't even supposed to be around to succeed, because when he was born, there was an edict that went out that all of the male babies was to be killed and placed in the Nile River, and but God preserved him. Moses was already supposed to be dead, but God kept him. And if the devil had his way, and if some folk who don't like you, if some of your haters had their say so, you wouldn't be here, but God kept you. When you were doing anything and some of everything, that you were big enough and bad enough, pretty enough and ugly enough to do it, amen, in spite of you, God kept you. And Moses now, amen, 80 years later was supposed to already be dead, but God let Pharaoh's daughter see him or hear him crying in the bulrushes of the Nile, and God let him take him from the water and take him home to be her own child, and then turn around and hide his mama as his nanny. God used people. But he uses the people that he has preserved for his purpose. Thank God for your preserving power, all to be kept. That'd be a good hymn for you to be turning to, Archie Ray. Amen. All to be kept. People preserved and prepared. Now God took 40 years of Moses' life in the desert to prepare him. And all of the pain and all of the struggles and all of the strife and all of the heartaches and all of the hard times and all of the disappointment that you have been, that you've gone through in your life, that was God's way of preparing you. God didn't get no sick pleasure out of watching you cry yourself to sleep at night. God didn't get any pleasure out of your heart being broken, being disappointed in life. God have used your dental experience, your real life experience, in order to prepare you. See, for this journey, every now and then, you need some experiences with God. Every now and then, you need to fail. I know all of us running, trying to make 100, couple, you know, 99 and a half won't do, but every now and then, amen, you need to fail. Because it is in the failures of life that you learn your most valuable lesson. Every now and then, you need to run a little short on what you need. Sometimes you need to be in want. Because when you learn, when you're in want and you need, and you can't put your hands on what you need, you learn in life to wait on the Lord. You don't have no choice. Every now and then, this old body needs to break down and let pathogens creep in, and the body get a little sick and let some viruses roam. You need those experiences because that's God's way of training you for the journey. Because let me tell you something, brothers and sisters, you think what you've been through, amen, was an ordeal. Wait until you run up on Pharaoh. And what you'll find out, brothers and sisters, when God gives you an experience, it does not make you subservient to somebody with an opinion. When you have experience with God, it is nothing, amen, when you have meet a person with an argument. Because, brothers and sisters, I can tell you, when I know that I was down and the only way that I got back up was that God reached way down and picked me up, it really don't matter what you say. You see me hollering and shouting and praising God, and you tell me your argument, it don't take all that, baby, if you've been where I be. And you talk about me shouting, amen, I ought not stop shouting. But God uses your experience in your desert moment like he did Moses on the backside of the desert. He was supposed to be in the palace, but he's in the desert. He was supposed to be a prince, but now he's a pauper. Amen. He was supposed to have riches, but now he's poor. He was supposed to be able to marry another prince, but now he got a farmer's daughter for a wife and driving sheep in the wilderness. God used his wilderness experience to prepare him. It wasn't 40 years, but it was another fella I know. Well, 40 days. And before he ever spoke a word in the name of the Lord, amen, before he ever showed up at weddings and turned water intertwined without fermentation, amen, before he ever showed up at pools that where lame folk were and made them walk, and before he ever put his fingers in deaf ears and unstopped them, before he ever took the scissors and cut loose stammering tongues, before he ever stopped funeral processions and told dead folk to get up and go on back home, before God, before he did all of that, Jesus spent 40 days in the wilderness. Being tempted by the devil. Because the Lord knows that when he would come out of the desert after 40 days, he was going to have to contend with the Pharaohs that were called Pharisees and with those that were called Sadducees. He prepared him. So if you're going through something, amen, and you think it is the devil's playground, amen, it's just God's preparation ground. The Lord prepared Moses. 40 years on the backside of the Midianite desert, and one day the Lord took something that was ordinary in the desert and it turned it into an extraordinary experience. The desert was arid. The desert was dry. They had broom brushes. You all watch Western movies and seen tumbling weed. Amen. It was not uncommon for brush brooms to catch on fire in the desert, but this fire was a different fire. Every now and then the Lord would send a different fire. Every now and then, God would take the ordinary and make it extraordinary. God would take Monday and make it a special Monday. Because in the desert, Moses saw an ordinary bush on fire. But what was extraordinary about this bush, that it kept on burning. And it was not consumed. So this would-be missionary, the Lord got his attention. Every now and then the Lord have to get our attention. We cannot hear him in our ordinary movement. And God have to do something to get our attention. And so then Moses turned aside to see this thing that was burning but wouldn't burn up. And he heard out of the bush, amen, the voice of God who called him by his name. And I need you to know, brothers and sisters, no matter if you are in hiding, if you are on the backside of your desert, God knows where you are and he knows you by name. Are y'all listening to me? And from the bush, Moses, hear his name, Moses. Moses. He called his name twice. And I'm going to tell you something. Every time the Lord in the Bible calls somebody's name two times, he getting ready to use them in a mighty way. You remember Samuel in the temple with the prophet Eli, amen. He heard his name Samuel, Samuel, and God would call him to anoint the first king and turn around and make him the last judge of Israel. God is about to get ready to do something great, amen, in his life, amen. I heard, brothers and sisters, Saul was on Damascus Road and the Lord called his name two times. Saul. Saul. Called Moses' name twice. Moses approached the burning bush. And the Lord said unto Moses, don't come any further. I need you to take off your shoes, because the ground that you're standing on is holy ground. Yeah. And just in case Moses didn't remember, the Lord introduced himself to Moses one more time. Moses, yeah, this is a God calling. Moses, you remember me, that I am the God of your father. God introduces himself, saying, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And I heard my people cry. Yeah, and I seen that oppression. And I want you to go from this wilderness. Yeah, I've been working on you for 40 years. And I need you to go down to Egypt and confront Pharaoh and tell him to let my people go. Yeah, I'm sending you on a missionary journey. And Moses got some questions from the Lord. Yeah, seeing that I'm wanted for murder in Egypt, and I cannot speak well when I get down. Yeah, and they ask me who it is that sent me. God said to him, you tell them I am that I am. Yeah, you see, in Semitic world, your name signified characteristics about you. And from time to time, the name of God would change and he revealed himself. But you tell them that I am. Yeah, I want you to tell them I'm not just I'm a provider, but I am that I am. And I don't want you to just tell them that I'm Jehovah Shalom, but let them know that I am the self-existing God, the self-sustaining God. The God, amen, whose organs cannot be determined, neither can it in the end. Tell them that I am sent you. Is there anybody else who knows that I am God? Yes, whatever you need, heal that I am God. If you hungry, he said, I am the bread of life. He said, I am God. If you thirsty, he said, I am, amen, the water of life. If you are in darkness, he said, I am the light of the world. Yeah, if you, amen, are living in falsehood, he said, I am the truth, amen. When you're lost, I am the way. Even if you are dead, I am the life. And Moses, yeah, started on his missionary journey. I told God, they told Pharaoh what the Lord told him. gave him God the purpose, and Moses, by the presence and the power of God, led the children out of Egypt. Can I get a witness here? And Moses standing by the Red Sea, he can't go forward. Yeah, mountains on the left and the right, can't turn to the side and look behind him was Pharaoh's army. And the Lord just told him, I got you on this mission journey, but I promise you, before you left the desert, that I was gonna go with you, and I was gonna move for you. And I see God just telling Moses, stand right here, be still, and watch me work. And I'm gonna put it down to word to somebody this morning to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. And Moses, use the rod one more time. The same old rod that he heard in secret. The same old rod that he climbed the mountain of God with. The same rod that he threw on the ground and turned to a serpent. The same rod that he lifted up in the battle. The same rod he stepped out over the land and God opened the water. Yeah, God made a missionary out of an ordinary Moses. And I'm reminded one more time, there was an ordinary man, yeah, who had a young mother who was a teenager. And I feel with him, he hadn't got married yet, but ended up pregnant. And I feel with him, and she was from the ghettos of Nazareth. I see her. God using this ordinary woman and putting her womb a baby who named Jesus, who was the same age as his daddy and older than his mama. Yes, yes, God used this ordinary boy, put his spirit in him, sent him to Calvary and died for the sins of the world. But that's not how the story ends. Missionaries are not just born, they're made. I was in the barber shop with Fred Brown. Anybody know Fred Brown? He's a good guitar player. And I said, boy, I sure wish I had any one of them guitars out there. And he said, Reverend, he said, a good guitar player, they're hard to find. And I told Fred, you know what? That's your fault. And he said, what do you mean by that? Only guitar players make other guitar players. If you don't train, younger folk to do what you are now doing, you look up, won't nobody be on the drums? Won't nobody be on the piano? Nobody be in the choir stand, hawk, you won't have no others. I said that to say this, we are in the missionary making business. We're supposed to reproduce after I can. If you got a church full of hell raisers, I bet you I can find some old hell raisers. You got a church full of liars? I bet you I can show you some old liars. Because you can only produce after you can. We are to be in the missionary making business. Jesus looked out and the need was so great. At the end of the day, he was so tired. He said, truly the harvest is plenty. But we got employment issues. We got jobs, but we ain't got no workers. The laborers are few. This is what he says to us, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers. That he will send laborers. And when the Lord send them to us, it's our job to train them, to make them. Church is church. But church is also a school. Did y'all know that? And for two or three generations back, the very first church, the very first school that our folks attended, this church. We moved so far away from the stuff that really made us. That made us. Lou, when we came along, there wasn't no little people daycare. Rev Scott and Rev Pinker ride around the station wagon. No seat belts. With a wagon full of children. And they began to train us. I would to God that every church, especially every Baptist church, no matter how small you are, there ought to be child development centers in our churches. There ought to be in our churches. Not just to make money, but to train our children. These little black babies of ours, they're small children. And they talk about making pre-K universal. When these children get to pre-K, they already know how to line cups. And the teacher got to use the first semester to get out of them what's already in them. And then use the second semester to start teaching them. I just want us to get serious about the work. I want us to be very serious about the work. Church is not only a place of worship, but church is a school. My mom's first school was at the same place that she would listen to the preacher on Sunday. Down at Mount Zion Baptist Church. And I believe that we have moved so far away from God and so far away from our roots that it's hard for us to reel our folk back in. Almost like hurting cats. But we let it go on too far. Too long. The door of church is open. We should come back at a Christian experience. Making up a mistake. You got that song? You ain't got it ready? Fuck.
Yeah.
All right, come on. Come on. Come on. She'll show it to you. Hey, amen. Thank God for us for our musicians, too. Yeah, when we get a musician, I'd like for them. It's all right to run up and down the keyboard. I need somebody who can read. I need somebody. The door of church is going to be a mission. Come by the Christian experience of candidate for baptism. This is the invitation that God will make us, amen, what we need. That we will not be having when we do bring it back. We will not be having summer school on first Sundays. I know that much. Amen. When we come for communion and preaching that on first Sunday, that's all we're going to do. Amen. We don't even have to announce on first Sunday that you're going to be reported. Amen. Y'all been told before I got here. On first Sunday, you already know what to do. Amen. But it won't look like it used to look. Mission won't look like it used to look.
Yeah.
Amen. But guess what? We're going to be just as serious about it and do whatever it is that we need to do to carry out the Lord's work. Amen. God bless you today. God bless you.
Oh,
The Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord lift his countenance upon you and be gracious.